Let me continue with 2D harmonic oscillator, okay? Because a lot of people actually watch these videos to learn physics and not to listen to my personal opinions. So 2D harmonic oscillator, right? What are the main points, right? You have the Schrodinger equation. So, sorry, not 2D harmonic oscillator. I should just say 2D it's just a 2D system, any 2D system. So there is some kinetic energy, there is some potential energy. And this is the time independent Schrodinger equation. Now, the thing is that in one dimension, when you write down this derivative, right? In 1D, you have one momentum and that's equal to this d by dx. So, but in 2D and higher, in D greater than 2, greater than equal to 2, this P operator in general is given in terms of the gradient, right? So what is the gradient, right? The gradient is a vector operator, right? It looks like this, dx, dy, dz, right? In general, let's say you are working in n dimensions, then it will be d1, d2, d3, till dn, where n is the number of dimensions. Right. But now the thing is that for d greater than or equal to 2, one can have different coordinate systems. Right? So Cartesian is one. Cartesian is the one that we all know and love. But one can also have a polar system or a spherical system or a cylindrical system, cylindrical coordinates, right? Or elliptical coordinates or hyperboloidal coordinates. So there are n number of different kinds of coordinate systems, right? So in 2D, so this spherical, cylindrical, elliptical, hyperboloidal and all, these are in 3D. Though in 2D also you can have like a hyperboloidal system, hyperboloidal this thing, coordinates or elliptical coordinates. So in 2D, you have so your Cartesian coordinate is the usual one, x, y. But then you also have polar coordinates. Polar coordinates is r theta, right? And what is the relationship between the two coordinate systems? This is r, right? It's just the distance of the point from the distance of the point from the origin, and then theta is equal to this, So it is written in this way. Right? You have x and y. And then you have some point here. So this is theta and this is r, right? So the inverse coordinate transformation is x is equal to r cosine theta and y is equal to r sine theta, right? This is the usual standard expression. Now, so the thing is that, let's say that you have, so your potential, this potential function, right? This potential function, it's a function on a plane, right? So it can have certain symmetries. Right? I mean, you can have, for instance, you can have a potential which is completely random. Like if you have a random potential, like in 1D, a random potential would look like this. Let's say this is a 1D random potential, right? It is like a rough surface. Then you can have a random potential in 2D also, same thing in 2D or 3D, meaning that in 2D, you would imagine it to be like a mountainous range. There are hills and there are valleys and so on. So there is no symmetric. These are such potentials, random potentials, are also known as disordered systems. So these random potentials are very important actually in understanding real systems. Because in real systems, in real world systems, what happens is you have some lattice, let's say, but then you have impurities and you have defects, right? So in many cases, these impurities and defects, right, they modify the physics, and the way you model them, these guys, is by using a random potential. And so this is actually not a a problem. This leads to very, very interesting physics, and you can do very, very interesting things with disordered systems. You can, like, in terms of making devices and all, for instance, these are very important, but we will not be discussing how to work with disordered potentials. We'll work just with plain, simple, smooth potential. So we will work with, you know, for instance, so symmetries of, then we can have symmetric potential. So what is a symmetric potential? So for instance, let's say I have a potential which looks like this, like a box, right? So that means there is some box-like region within which, let's say, V is equal to infinity, and outside which V is zero, outside V is infinity, right? So this is like a infinite potential well. If you want to visualize this, how would you visualize it? You would think that, well, there is some surface, and there is a hole in the surface. So there is a hole in this surface, and you have right. So the top part of the surface, this part, is where V is equal to V naught, and the interior part, this here, you have V is equal to zero. So if you have a classical particle, for instance, the classical particle will tend to sit in the bottom of the potential. It will tend to stay within this region, right? And if you take limit V naught goes to infinity, then you get an infinite potential wave, right? Now the thing is that the shape of your potential affects the form of the solutions. Of the Schrodinger equation. So for example, for a rectangular or a square potential, this corresponds to a system which has translational symmetry. So what is translational symmetry? It means that if I move in the x direction or the y direction, the system looks the same, right? So if you look at this kind of picture, when you are inside the hole, inside the well, right, you have a symmetry, right? You can move in the x or y axis independently. But you know, one can also have a circular hole, let's say. So then one would have a circular symmetry. So one could have this thing, or axial symmetry, one would call it. So let's say one has a potential, then this would correspond to axial symmetry. So what is an example of an axially symmetric potential? So this translational symmetry, for instance, is this what we have already seen, rectangular potential well. Right, it doesn't have to be square, it can be rectangular also. Axial symmetry is what? For instance, a potential of this form, let's say Vxy. Well, I can also write it as Vr theta, right? And as an example, if you consider a potential like this, K over R. So this does not depend on the angle, right? This doesn't depend on the angle. It's like a central force. So this thing has axial, in two dimensions, it has axial symmetry. In three dimensions, it has spherical symmetry, right? And so you can have this axially symmetric potential. Well, it's the same thing. You have a infinite potential outside, and inside the well, you have zero potential, and the size of the well is R, which is given in terms of the radius. So now the question is, how should you approach this system? So for this system, Cartesian coordinates are not advisable. Okay, why is that? Because, you know, Cartesian coordinates, it's clear that in this case your system has different symmetry. It has axial symmetry, right? So in other words, instead of writing your state as this, it is better to write it as a function of r theta. So then what will happen is that typically you can what should I call it? Something eta theta. So what you can do is that in many cases, the wave function will become a product of a radial component and an angular component. Right? And this is also exactly what happens, for instance, in the rectangular case, right? In the 2D potential well, in the rectangular case, the wave function becomes a product of the X component state and the Y component, the solution in the Y component, right? So you have separability. But now the thing is that what about the gradient operator? Because the gradient operator is normally written as this thing, right? IH bar dx dy. But we can't use that. We are not working in the dx dy coordinates, right? We have to work, we have to write down this operator in terms of our radius and angular variable, right? So if you do a transformation of coordinates, right? So you have to write it in terms of this dx and d theta. And in the Schrodinger equation, what is it that you use? You use this, right? You use dx square plus dy square, right? Times minus h bar square. So this thing, this expression is called del square, right? Which is called a Laplacian. So what will be the Laplacian, for instance, in polar coordinates? Well, you might think that the Laplacian would be of this form, let's say. But this is not correct because this expression doesn't have the right dimension. D by d theta, right? Theta is dimensionless. So what should be the dimensions of the Laplacian? 1 by L square, right? The dimension of a derivative operator is 1 by L. So the dimension of the derivative squared is 1 by L squared. And please interrupt me and ask me if something I'm saying is not clear, okay? So instead, what is this Laplacian? What is the correct expression? You have to put a factor of 1 by R squared. This makes the dimensions dimensionality of the system correct, right? And in case you forget how to do this, let me remind you. So what you want to do is you want to write down d by dx, right? So let's just put a dummy function f just to work out the expression, right? Now x is a function of r and theta, right? So how do you write this? You write this as using the chain rule. So if in case you have not worked this out at some point in your life, you need to do this, okay? So it is whenever you have this, you know, I mean, you in three dimensions, for instance, you would have three variables, r, theta, phi. This is in 2D, right? In 3D, what would happen? You would get df by dr, dr by dx, df by d theta, you would get one extra term. So this is the chain rule for a function of n variables, right? You can always write down the derivative in this way. So now, what is dr by dx and d theta by dx? This we can calculate, right? Dr by dx. We know what dr is, right? Dr is root of x square plus y square by dx. So the answer becomes equal to x by r. What is x by r? X by r is cosine theta, right? And what is d theta by dx? D theta is d of tan inverse y by x by dx, right? So the derivative of tan inverse, so wait, what is this? Well, this is something. I'll leave this for you, okay? You work it out. One more. So when you put these expressions together, right? So what you will find is that, for instance, df by dx will become this dr by dx, which is cosine theta, times df by dr. And then you will have d theta by dx. D theta by dx, I think it will be r sine theta. I think it will be r sine theta. You need to check this, okay? Times df by d theta. So this tells you that if you just look at the derivative operator, d by dr, that is equal to d by d theta. And similarly for dy. So dy will become this thing. And then there is a minus sign. And right. So this r should be in the numerator. Okay. Because otherwise, again, the dimensions would not match. This is 1 by r. So this also needs to have dimensions of inverse length. So this will be, I think, cosine theta by r. So if you take the square of both of these and you add it, right, what will happen if you square these two expressions? Dx square will become cosine square dr square sine square theta by r square d theta square plus 2 times sine theta cosine theta by r dr d theta. Now actually what will happen is you will get dr d theta plus d theta dr. But these two commute. So you can ordinary partial derivatives, they commute with each other, right? The order of the derivative does not matter. That is why I can write this factor of 2. right? Otherwise, if you remember, when you have a product of operators like this, you have to keep the order intact. And similarly, dy square will be sine square theta dr square plus cosine square theta by r square d theta square. And then there will be a term with a minus sign, minus 2 sine theta cosine theta by r dr d theta. So when you add these two, what do you get? You get dr square plus 1 by r square d theta square. And this is the Laplacian in polar coordinates. Okay?